Hello, my dear students. My name is Vishwanath Sharma, working as assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. And welcome back to the course of Discrete Mathematical Structures. In the previous class, we have discussed about mathematical logic, and then we discussed about relations, functions, and algebraic structures. And in the last unit, we discussed about recurrence relations. Now coming to the last topic of last unit of this particular course is graph theory, which is very, very important in this discrete mathematical structures. So let us start. What is graph theory? First, we'll try to introduce what is graph theory, and then we'll discuss slowly what are the important contents are there in this particular graph theory. So now coming to the contents of the graph theory, we are going to discuss about the first topic here. It is basic concepts of graphs. That means what do you mean by a graph, and what is the terminology which we are going to use in this particular graph? That is what we are trying to discuss. And the second one is representation of graphs. So what are the different ways of representing the graph? Because when we want to implement these particular graphs, if you want to store it in the computer memory, you need to store it in a particular form. So what are the different forms you are going to represent this graph? These are the two topics which we are going to discuss in our introductory class of graph theory. Now coming to the introduction to graph theory. So the graph theory was first studied by the super famous mathematician Leonhard Euler in 1735. He is a famous mathematician who initially was introduced this particular graph theory in the year 1735, based on one important problem. We'll try to discuss that problem afterwards. So what is the importance of this particular graph theory? So we know that most of the real world problems can be conveniently, we are going to represent in the form of graphs, so that it has to be visible to the all the users, and not only that, which will give you the clear information what is going on in that particular problem. So the better way of representing the information is in a particular diagram. So that's why that diagram can be represented here where it is in the form of a graph. That is what many real world situations can be conveniently described by means of what diagram, which may consist of set of what points together with lines joining certain parts of these points. So now let us try to understand what exactly is here. First, we are going to discuss here it consists of what set of points together with lines joining certain pairs. So whenever you are a diagram which consists of like this, there we are going to use this particular graph theory. So that is the importance of mathematical abstraction of the situation of this type of gives rise to the concept of a graph. So whenever, suppose for example, if you want to travel from here to Hyderabad, so what are the different ways we exist to travel from here to Hyderabad? So there may be direct way, there may be a direct way, there may not be a direct way. You can go to some other place, from there you can reach the Hyderabad, or you can go to one place, from there you can reach the another place, and from there you can reach the another place and reach the Hyderabad. So these are the different ways of reaching Hyderabad from source to the destination. So how do we represent this particular problem? So to represent this particular problem, the better way of representing this particular problem is in the form of a graph. So once you are going to represent this particular in the form of a graph, but if you want to represent it in the computer memory, it is not possible to represent exact this graph in the computer memory. So what we need to do here, we need to convert this graph into the form of in another form. So what are those from? That is what we can call it as representation of the graph. So this is what the basic introduction of what graph theory. Now coming to the definition of a graph. What is the definition of a graph? Basically, the graph is defined like this. It is an ordered pair of what? G equal to V comma E, where V is what? A non-empty set of vertices. and E is nothing but set of edges. So that means when you are going to take like this, this is, suppose I am going to draw a particular diagram like this, this is the source and this is the destination. Suppose like this I am taking. Let us consider this is the A, B, C and D. These are there. This is called a node. It is called a node or vertex. And this is called edge. It is called an edge. So a graph is nothing but what? It is an order pair of what? G equal to set of order pair of V comma E. The number of vertices and these vertices are connected by what? Edges. What are those edges? That means the A and B, these are the two vertices, and these two vertices are connected by this particular edge. And A and C are connected by this particular edge. B and C are connected by this is the edge. So basically, we are trying to represent a graph. This is called a graph. Graph. This is how we can represent a graph, which is a non-empty set. See, why it is a non-empty set? We, because if there are no vertices, then it is not possible to draw a what graph. Therefore, even though edges may be, suppose if I can take like this, there is no edge in this diagram. If you consider only this particular diagram, in this diagram what happened? There are only vertices, but there are no edges. Even though still we can consider it to be a graph. But if there are no vertices, what will happen? It is not possible to draw anything. So it is not possible to represent in the form of a graph. That's why a graph consists of what? A non-empty set of vertices and what? A set of edges. Edges may be empty, but vertices may not be empty. I have taken one graph. This is the one graph. If you observe this particular graph, this is called, because here in this graph, we can move from A to B, or you can move from B to A. A to D or D to A. A to C or C to A. Here, in this graph, if you clearly observe that, so in which direction you are going, it is not mentioned. The direction is not mentioned. That's why it is called undirected graph. This is called an undirected graph. Why? Because here the directions have not mentioned. Just they have mentioned the vertices. And in between those vertices, there are some edges which are represented like this. This is called a undirected graph. There is another graph. For example, if you consider like this. Now let us come to the case of this. What happened here? See, here there is a edge which consists of a direction. Here there is an edge which does not consist of a direction. So that's why it is called an undirected graph. But here it is. It is not possible to come back to from 2 to 1. But here you can go A to B, or you can come from B to A. But here you can go only from 1 to 2. But it is not possible to come back from 2 to 1 because there is no such direction exists here. Therefore, it is called a directed graph. This is called directed graph. A graph which consists of the directions is called a directed graph. A graph which consists of, which does not consist of direction, then it is called undirected graph. Undirected graph. This is. So like this, we have different types of graphs which we are going to discuss. Initially, you must know about basic graphs like undirected graph and what? Directed graph. Let us come to the very, very important part of this particular introduction part. That is what? Terminology. We are going to use some terms, so you should know about the definitions of those terms, because which we are going to use regularly in this particular graph theory while we are doing the problem. So what are those terms? Let us try to understand those. The first one is, if you go through the definition of this, if an edge has only one endpoint, then it is called a loop edge. Means what? So that means if you take a vertex like this, this is a particular vertex. If an edge has only one endpoint, when it consists of only one endpoint, but if you take like this, If it is a directed graph, then this is the only one endpoint. Is it clear? If it is not a directed graph, then what happened? It consists of only one endpoint like this. Then if the loop, if any graph which consists of only one endpoint, the edge has only one endpoint like this, then what we can call it as a loop edge. This is called the loop edge. If an edge consists of only one endpoint, this is the first terminal. What do you mean by the loop edge? And the second one, if two or more edges have the same endpoints, then they are called multiple or parallel edges. So what do you mean by this? If two or more edges have the same endpoints, what do you mean by that? Same endpoints. That means suppose I am taking one vertex like this, the another vertex is like this, and this is the one edge and this is the another edge, suppose. Now if you observe that for this edge, if you start from here, this is the endpoint. For this edge, if you start from here, this is the endpoint. So two or more, here I have taken two edges which has the same endpoint here. Therefore, these two edges are called parallel edges. This is in case of what? Undirected graph. Because in undirected graph, the endpoint may be this or the endpoint may be this. Because you can travel from here to here or you can travel from here to here. Anyway, you can travel. So therefore, here in both, this is for only undirected graph. Now coming to the directed graph, if you take a directed graph, now let us take like this. Again, I am going to take. Suppose if you take like this, because if you observe that the both the directions are going towards this particular vertex, that means for this particular edge, this is what? The endpoint. And similarly for this particular edge, this is the endpoint. Therefore, in this case, they are called parallel edges. But coming to the case of, now let us take another example like this. In this case, what happened? In this case, this particular edge is coming from here. So for this particular edge, this is the endpoint. And for this particular edge, this is the endpoint. So that is not, in that case, they are not called parallel edges or multiple edges. So parallel edges means two or more edges have the same endpoint. But here for this particular edge, this is the endpoint. And for this particular edge, this is the endpoint. Therefore, there are two different endpoints are there. Therefore, they are not called parallel edges. So parallel edges means they consist of the two or more edges consist of same endpoint. Another definition is two vertices that are joined by an edge are called adjacent vertices. Vertices, that means suppose you have taken vertices like this. This is the one vertex and this is the another vertex. Now coming to the case when you are going to join these two vertices by using a edge like this, let us take this is an edge E and this is V1, this is V2 vertex. Now because these two vertices are joined by an edge, therefore it is called, these two are called V1 and V2. V1 and V2 are adjacent. Suppose I can take like this another vertex V3. In that case, V1 and V2 are adjacent. V2 and V3 are also adjacent. But V1 and V3 are not adjacent. Why? Because they are not connected by any edge. Therefore, they are not called adjacent vertices. These two are adjacent vertices and these two are adjacent vertices, but these two are not called adjacent vertices because they are not connected by any edge. This is the definition of a adjacent vertex. Two edges are said to be adjacent. Previously, we defined it for vertices. When we say that two vertices are adjacent, now we are going to define it for edges. So two edges are said to be adjacent, two edges, if there is a common vertex between the two edges. Means that what? Suppose let us take one example. So now let us come to the case of this particular example here. If you go through, let us come to the case of adjacent. So let us take adjacent vertices. First, we'll try to define the adjacent vertices. So A and B are adjacent vertices. These two are A and C are adjacent vertices. A and C both are. Similarly, B and C also adjacent because connected by an edge. D and C also adjacent. And finally, A comma D. This is adjacent. But B and D are not connected by any edge. Therefore, they are not adjacent. This is the come to the case of adjacent vertices. Now, in the similar way, we can go for adjacent edge. What are adjacent edges? So, as per the definition of adjacent edges, there should be a common vertex what? Between two edges. Means, if you go through this particular edge and this particular edge, these two edges are having a common vertex of what? A. Therefore, let us represent E1, this is E2, this is E3, E4 and E5. Now, E1 and E2 are adjacent edges. Just I am writing adjacent edges only here. E1 and E2 are adjacent. Similarly, E1, see, E1 and E3 are also adjacent because both are sharing the same vertex. Now, E2 and E3 also adjacent. Like this we can take. And then what? E1 and E4 also adjacent. You can take E1 and E4. Similarly, E2 and E4 also adjacent. If you observe that this particular edge and this particular edge are sharing the same vertex, therefore. And then E4 and E5 are also adjacent. E4 and E5 are also adjacent. Like this we can write. E2 and E5 are also adjacent. So, like this we can write the adjacent what? Edges. These are the adjacent vertices and these are the adjacent edges. This is how we can define both. Coming to the another important definition, degree of vertex. The number of vertices adjacent to a vertex V is called degree of the vertex. Just now we defined the number of vertices adjacent to a vertex. So here, if a vertex consists of a 1 degree, then it is called a pendant vertex. A vertex which consists of a single degree, then it is called a pendant vertex. Similarly, a vertex with no degree is called isolated vertex. Let us try to understand these three definitions by an example. I'm giving you one example. This is the example. Let us try to understand here. Now, the number of vertices adjacent to a vertex V, or adjacent to a vertex V means what? That means at this particular vertex, what are the edges it is going to? The number of edges which are adjacent to that particular vertex. That means what here? So let us take a vertex here, vertex adjacent to a vertex, so is, and it is denoted by degree of V. This is what? So now let us take A. Let us take degree. Let us define degree here. So coming to the vertex A, what is the degree of vertex? This is the one vertex which is adjacent to this particular vertex. And this is the another vertex which is particular to this vertex. So there are two vertices which are adjacent to what? A. Those are B and D. Therefore, the degree is here, it is 2. That is. Similarly, coming to the case of vertex B, let us try to understand what is the degree. For this particular vertex here, what are the adjacent vertices? C is the one adjacent vertex, A is the another one, D, because it is sharing all, there are edges in between those, so B has a degree 3. Similarly, what is the degree of C here? C degree is, it is having only one adjacent vertex, that is what? B. Therefore, the degree of C is 1. And similarly, coming to the case of D, so for this D, what is the adjacent vertex? This is the one adjacent vertex and this is the another vertex. For D, A and B are adjacent vertices. So therefore, the degree of A equal to 2. Now coming to the degree of E, what is the degree of E? It is not sharing any edge with any other vertices. Therefore, you will not get any adjacent vertex. Therefore, what? The degree of E becomes 0. This is how we are going to take the degree of each vertex. So here, if you observe that the vertex C has only one degree, therefore it is called pendent. It is called a pendent vertex. And degree of E, if you go through this particular E degree, it has 0, therefore it is called isolated vertex. This is called isolated vertex. So I hope it is clear for you how to get the degree of a particular vertex. Remember that to get the degree of a particular vertex, you try to identify the number of adjacent vertices to that particular vertex. That is the degree of a vertex. If the degree of the vertex is equal to 1, then it is called a pendent vertex. If the degree of the vertex is equal to 0, then it is called a isolated, means it is not sharing any edge with any other vertices in the given graph. This is what the definition of a degree of a vertex. To the in a directed graph, see previously, if you go through the previous slide, here we have defined the degree of a vertex of what? An undirected graph. This is an undirected graph. There are no directions in this particular graph. Now let us try to define the same thing for what? A directed graph. So in a directed graph, each vertex has in degree and out degree. But in undirected graph, there is no in degree and there is no out degree. Why? Because we are going to define here in degree and out degree. Because there is a direction, some edges will move out from that particular vertex and some edges will come into that particular vertex. Therefore, which are going out from that particular vertex, that is called the out degree, which are coming towards that particular vertex, they are called the, that is called the in degree. That's why we need to define in degree and out degree here. For the previous case, no need to define both these two. Simply we are going to define what is a degree. Now let us try to understand what is in degree and out degree for this particular directed graph. This is a directed graph because what? It has directions. So now let us take a vertex here and then in degree, out degree. Let us try to define this. So let us come to the case of A, in degree. What do you mean by the in degree? In degree is calculated by the number of vertices or the number of edges which are coming towards that particular vertex. That means at this particular vertex, which edge is coming, how many number of edges are coming? Only this particular edge is coming towards this. There is no other edge which is coming towards this particular vertex. Therefore, the in degree is equal to 1. But coming to the out degree, the number of edges which are leaving from this particular vertex, how many number of edges which are leaving from this particular vertex? Only 1. Therefore, it is called the out degree. Similarly, coming to the case of B. Now, coming to the case of B, how many number of edges which are coming towards B? There is no edge which is coming towards B. Therefore, the vertex is 0. But if you observe that at the vertex B, this particular edge is going outside and this particular edge is also going out. So two edges are going out. Therefore, out degree is equal to 2. Now coming to this degree vertex C. So coming to this particular vertex, this particular edge is coming towards this and this particular edge is also coming towards this. Therefore, two edges are coming towards the vertex C. Therefore, the degree is 2. But no edge is going out from this particular what? Vertex. Therefore, the out degree is 0. And similarly, D, if you take it for D, Now what happened? For this D, only this particular edge is coming towards this. There is no other edge which is coming towards this. Therefore, the degree in degree is 1. And the out degree. So if you observe this particular edge is going out from D, therefore the out degree is also equal to 1. And finally, E. What is E? This edge is coming towards this and this edge is going towards this. Therefore, in degree is 1 and out degree is also 1. So this is how we can calculate in degree and out degree. What is the sum of in degree here? 3 plus 2, 5 here, and here 3 plus 2, 5. This is the sum of in degree and sum of the out degree. So this is how we can calculate what? The in degree and out degree for a given directed graph. For an undirected graph, no need to calculate in degree and out degree. Just try to mention only what is degree. Degree means the number of adjacent vertices, or the another way we can define it for the undirected graph is the number of edges which are coming towards that particular vertex are also called the degree of the vertex. This is the way we can define the degree. The next important term is subgraph. What is a subgraph? Till now we discussed about what you mean by a graph. A graph is nothing but what? Which consists of vertices and edges. The vertices must not be empty, but edges may be empty. Okay? But what is a subgraph? Let us try to understand the definition first. A subgraph, S of a graph G is a graph. The first point it has to satisfy is that whose vertex set V of S is a subset of the vertex set V of G. That is, V of S is subset to V of G. Because it consists of these edges also, the edge of that particular subgraph should also be the subset of the edge of the given graph. This is very, very important. Now let us try to understand this here. If you go through this particular graph, this is the given graph here. And all these graphs are what? Subgraphs to the given graph. Now let us try to understand this. This is what? See here, this is the given graph. Here, this particular edge does not mention, this particular edge does not mention in the first picture here, in coming to the first pic. But whether it's satisfying the two properties or not, you have to check it. The number of vertices, how many number of vertices are here? Here all 6 vertices, here also 6 vertices are there. But the number of edges here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 edges are there for this graph, but here 6 only, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 edges are there. So the number of edges is subset of what? See, this edge and this edge, in between these two vertices, there is an edge here. In between these two vertices, there is an edge here. Suppose if there is no edge like this, then also it is a subgraph. If you observe the next figure, it is a subgraph. This is a subgraph. That is also a subgraph. So these are all the subgraphs of what? The given graph. So subgraph means it has to satisfy these two properties. Now coming to the second part. Till now we discussed about the important terminology which is used in the graphs. The first one is nothing but what? What is a loop edge? And second one is parallel edges. Means two or more edges having the same endpoint, then it is called a parallel edge. That is what? What is adjacent vertex? What do you mean by adjacent edge? And then we discussed about what is a degree for undirected graph and degree for what? Directed graph. And then in the last slide, we discussed about what do you mean by a subgraph. A subgraph is a graph. The vertices of the graph should be the subset of what? The main graph, given graph, and edges also subset of the given graph. If these two properties hold, then it is called a subgraph of the given graph. The next one is, another important topic is how to represent the graph. It is very, very important. While you are representing the graphs in the computer memory, you need to represent by using these representations. Like one is called adjacent matrix representation. Another one is called adjacent list representation. Let us try to understand these two representations here. So most commonly used representations of a graph are adjacency matrix, the first one is, and the second one is adjacency list. So let us try to understand what is adjacency matrix. The first one is adjacency matrix. So in this representation, what we are trying to do here, we have to construct a matrix. Because it is an adjacency matrix, we try to construct a matrix first, an n by n matrix. Remember that it is a square matrix. So how do we construct a matrix? If there is an edge from a vertex I to vertex j, there is an edge from vertex I to vertex j, then the corresponding element of A is equal to what? 1. If from one vertex to another vertex there is an edge, then we can say that the particular column, in that particular column you need to put 1. If there is no edge, then you simply put what? Otherwise, what you can get here, you will get it is equal to 0. This is how you can construct a matrix for a given particular graph. So let us try to understand this by using an example. So undirected graph representation here. So this is the given graph. So this is an undirected graph and it is represented in matrix form like this. This is called the adjacency matrix. This is called adjacency matrix. So here if you observe this particular, it is an n by n matrix, totally 5 vertices are there, so therefore you will get 5 by 5 matrix. So A, B, C, D, E like this, and you have to take in the column also same thing, you can take same vertices, and rows also in the same vertices. So A to A, if you observe that, is there any loop edge from A to A? There is no edge from A to A. Therefore, in that particular column, we have taken 0. Now, if you take from A to B, there is an edge from A to B. Therefore, we can take it as is equal to 1. Similarly, let us take A to C. There is an edge. Therefore, we have taken 1. A to D, there is an edge. We have taken 1. And A to E, there is no edge. Therefore, it is represented by what? 0. Similarly, we can do it for B. So let us try to do it for B. Come to the case of D. Because there is a self loop for the vertex, what? D. So D to D, it is equal to 1. Here it is mentioned D to D equal to 1. D to B, there is a edge. D to A, there is an edge. D to E, there is an edge. D to C, there is an edge. That means from this particular vertex to all other vertices which are mentioned in the graph, there is an edge. Therefore, this entire row consists of what? All are ones. This is how simply we can represent a given undirected graph in the matrix representation. Because it is not possible to represent like this in the computer memory, it is possible to represent in the form of like this in an array representation. Therefore, we try to convert the given graph into the form of matrix representation. The second one, now let us try to understand it for directed graph. How do we represent? Let us try to understand. This is a directed graph because it has what? Directions. In the directed graph, if you observe that A to A, still there is no loop. Therefore, it is equal to what? 0. Therefore, it is equal to 0 here. But A to B, there is an edge. Therefore, it is equal to 1. And A to C, there is an edge. A to D, there is no edge. A to E, there is no edge. So A to C is there, A to D, there is no H, A to E, there is no H. Therefore, it is equal to 0. Now, coming to the case of B, B to E is there, B to D is there, and there is no other H from B to any other vertices. Therefore, B to E is equal to 1, B to D is equal to 1, and rest of all are equal to 0, like this. But coming to the case of undirected graph, A to B, you can take it is, suppose if you take A to B like this, this is an undirected graph. In this case, we can take, if you take A to B here, A to B is equal to 1, and if you take here, this is A, this is B, let us take like this, you can, A to B is equal to 1, and B to A also is equal to 1, in the case of what? Undirected graph. But in the case of directed graph, A to B is equal, A to B, we can represent what? It is equal to 1 because there is an edge between these two. But coming to the case of B to A, there is no such edge. Therefore, B to A is equal to what? 0. But in the case of undirected graph, you can get like this. This is the difference between these two representations. Now, adjacency matrix representation for weighted graph. What do you mean by weighted graph? We discussed about undirected graph, we discussed about directed graph. Now, this is undirected weighted graph. Weighted graph is nothing but each edge consists of some weight value. This is the value. Here, this is a value. In the previous case, if you go through the previous slide, in this slide, there are no values which are taken for edges. Therefore, this is simply an undirected graph. Now, coming to the case of this particular graph, what happened? We have taken the values for each edge. Therefore, it is called a weighted graph. So, how do we represent this in the form of a matrix? It is very simple. Whatever the value that particular edge consists of, that value we are going to put here. Instead of putting 1 and 0, now we are going to put that weight value in that particular column. That is the difference between matrix representation for undirected graph and undirected weighted graph. So, A to B, it is 7. Similarly, B to A also 7 only, if you take. But A to A, there is no, B to B, it is equal to 0. See, like this, we are going to get. D to D, it is given, there in edge 3, therefore, you will get. Similarly, A to C, if you write A to C, then similarly, you can write C to A. See, A to C is 8, C to A is also 8. So, 07850, 07850, 700106, 700106. What is this matrix? This matrix, if you observe that, if you take A equal to A and its transpose is also same, A equal to A transpose. So, such a matrix, what we can call it as a, in matrix theory, it is called symmetric matrix. So, for undirected graph, whatever the matrix you are going to get, that matrix is a symmetric matrix. Whether it is a weighted graph or whether it is non-weighted graph, the matrix, whatever you are going to get, it is a symmetric matrix. But coming to the case of directed graph, it is not the case. Let us, this is the first representation. The first representation of the graph is adjacency matrix representation, and the second representation is adjacency list representation. So, how do we represent like this one? So, to represent this, in this representation, for each vertex in the graph, we maintain the list of its neighbors. That means, when you consider a particular A, what are the neighbors of A? Neighbors of A is nothing but the edges which are connected from A to other vertices. A to B, there is a vertex edge, and A to C, there is a edge. So, these are called what? The neighbors of A. For node A, the neighbors are B and C. For node D, the neighbors are what? A is the one neighbor, E is the another neighbor, like this. Suppose if you take here, A, what happened? For A, B is the one neighbor and C is the another neighbor. Like this we are going to represent. For B, what happened? For B, this is the one neighbor and E is the another neighbor. So, D is the neighbor and that means, for this particular vertex, which are the nodes which come going out to other vertices, they are called the adjacency nodes of this particular vertex. This is how we can represent that. For C, this is what? D. For D, A, D, E. For E. For E, what happened? There are no edges which are going towards to other vertices like E to B or E to D. All vertices are coming towards E, but there is no edge which is coming from E to any other vertex. Therefore, there are no adjacency nodes for this. What? Nodes for this particular node. So, this is generally how we are going to represent the given graph in the form of adjacency list. So, one way of representing is the matrix. The another way of representation of the given graph is nothing but adjacency list. Because this can be, see, when you are going to represent in the form of the matrix, you can use the arrays to implement that. When you are going to represent in the form of adjacency list, you can go for linked list representation. So, you know very well about linked list representations and which will be going to teach in data structures, what do you mean by linked list, single linked list, double linked list. There you can understand what is exactly this particular linked list representation and how we are going to implement. Now coming to the last important topic in this particular introductory class of this is indistinct matrix. What do you mean by that? This is the another way of representing the given graph. So in the previous case, what we have done that, coming to the case of adjacency matrix or adjacency list representation, only we have taken the rows and the columns or edges. For a given graph, suppose any graph is given here, a simple graph you can take like this. This is a graph you can take like this. Suppose if you want to represent this one in the form of adjacency matrix representation, let us take this is node A here. You can write here it is B, here you can see. This is B, this is C, and here A, this is B, this is C. Now what happened, if you observe that the rows are vertices or the nodes and the columns are also what? The nodes. Both rows and columns can be taken as what? Nodes. But coming to the indistinct matrix representation, it is what we are trying to do. We are going to take the rows or the number of vertices which we are going to use in the graph, and the columns are the number of edges which we have taken in that particular graph. That is the difference between adjacency matrix representation and incidence matrix representation. Incident, so an edge is said to be incident means what? Suppose if you take a vertex like this, this is the one vertex, A vertex, and this is the another vertex, B. An edge is there between these. Then we can say that this particular edge is incident at vertex B. At the end point, if it is a directed graph, then the incidence of this particular edge is what? B. This is the node. If it is an undirected graph, the incidence of this particular edge is what? It may be A if you come from this side, or if you go from this side, it may be B, like that. That is called incidence. So now that's why, while you are trying to represent it in the form of incidence matrix, you need to be considered the edges as well as you need to be considered the vertices. But in the case of adjacency matrix, no need of like that. Both rows and columns are consisting of only what? Vertices or nodes. So in this incidence matrix representation, graph can be represented using a matrix of size. What is the matrix of size? In the previous case, it is 5x5 matrix or 6x6 matrix. All are what we are going to get? They are all what? Square matrices. Number of rows, number of columns. But coming to the case of incidence matrix, total number of vertices by total number of edges, which gives us what? It may be a square matrix, or it may not be a square matrix, it may be a rectangular matrix. Why? Because the number of vertices may not be equal to number of edges. It is n cross m. In the case of here, it is an n cross n. Like this we are going to take. So let us try to understand this very quickly so that you can columns represent the edges and rows represent the vertices. But you may get a question, how do we represent that? So here this matrix is filled with what? Three values, the 0, 1 and minus 1. So what is 0? 0 is used to represent row edge which is not connected to the column vertex. Similarly, 1 is used to represent the edge which is connected to outgoing edge, and minus 1 like this. So you may not understand like this. Let us try to understand this with an example. So that, let us consider this example. This is the given matrix here. A to B, there is C. How many edges are there here? The total number of vertices are 5. Here, these are the vertices. And how many edges are there? Already represented here, totally 8 edges are there. All the edges are taken in the column. Now, if there is an edge, see, from A to B, there is an edge and it is going towards B, E1. So therefore, A to E1 is represented with what? 1. Similarly, A to C, there is an edge which is going towards C, and therefore, A to C, A to E2, it is represented with 1. We are not representing with A to C, A to E1, because it is going towards C. Now coming to the E3, what happened here? A to E3, from A, the E3 is not moving towards outside. It is, E3 is coming towards inside, therefore it is represented with minus 1. When a particular edge is moving towards outside, then between A and even we are going to take 1. When a particular edge is coming towards that particular vertex, then between A and that particular edge we are going to take it as minus 1. That is what. If there is no edge like that, then we can simply call it as a 0. For example, you can take A to E4. Is there any connection between A to E4? There is no connection between A to E4, A to E6, A to E7, A to E5, A to E8. Therefore, all are zeros because there is no connection. And these two edges are going outside and this edge is coming inside. Whenever edge is coming inside towards that particular vertex, you have to represent with minus 1. Whenever an vertex is going out, edge is going outside from that vertex, you have to represent it with what? 1. So that is how we can construct this particular matrix. This matrix, what we can call it as a incidence matrix. This is the difference between adjacency matrix and incidence matrix. It is a rectangular matrix. So with this, I would like to conclude the introductory part of what? The graph theory, which is there in our syllabus. In this introductory part, we discussed about what is the definition of a graph and what the terminology, what are the different terms which we can use in the graph theory and how we are going to represent these graphs. Adjacency matrix representation, adjacency list representation, and finally incidence matrix representation. In the coming classes, we are trying to discuss about what are the different types of the graphs, what are the paths, and what are circuits, all these which we are going to discuss in the next class. Thank you very much.